You won't last a week if you don't release, so please release it all over me. I got no complaints as long as it rains. Let me be your dream tonight. Let me be your dream tonight. Let it rain on my face, I won't complain. Dump it on me all night. As warm as it is black, I won't complain. I can handle your class. Let me be your dream tonight. Let me be your dream tonight. Recycle your liquids, recycle your solids. Drop it on me, I won't complain. You got it, so give it a strain. Through each window pane. Let me be your dream tonight. Let me be your dream tonight. I'm into rain, I'm into warm. So pleasurable contractions, please come forth. I love what's yellow, warm and runny. I love what's dark, thick and chunky. I love what pours into my mouth. So that's what life is all about. Yeah, that's what life is all about. Let me be your dream tonight. Let me be your dream tonight. You won't last a week if you don't release. So please release it all over me. I got no complaints as long as you rain. So rain, rain on me. Rain, rain on me.
Hey freaks, it's Wednesday, September 5th, 2018. Coming up on the program today, I warn you about safe friends and why you would never want to be one of them. Plus, a rectum full of razor blades, Dickless Dan dupes a duo of dumb broads, and Alex Jones hits Marco Rubio where it hurts, the gay bathhouse.
It's the Distorted View Show with Tim Henson.
A lot of hot liquid poo just went out all at once.
Yeah, Tim Henson back here with you on this gloomy, stormy Wednesday, at least in dreary, shitty Cincinnati, Ohio. Cincinnati. God, I hate this town. Get me out of here. I need sweet release. Jesus, take the wheel. Or if you don't feel like driving, at least let me carpool with the great tormentor, destroyer of lives, collector of damned souls, and the king of deception, Satan. He'll know what to do with me. He knows where I want to go. Yes, I'm insinuating that hell is a better place than Cincinnati. All right, listen. Ooh, speaking of dark shit, I learned a new term today. Safe friends. There was a creep on Dr. Phil, which is not unusual. The show is filled with creeps, Dr. Phil being one of them. But this dude was really unhinged. He was talking about how he has this idea of safe friends. These are friends that could never possibly leave you. He must have been abandoned a lot as a child, and now he's probably a serial killer. Take a listen.
At least once a day I have this type of demonic thinking where I want to make certain people safe friends. A safe friend is somebody who can't leave or betray you, because you have them always. We could watch them. Unfortunately, to do that, you'd have to end their life.
At first it sounds kind of sweet. You know, I mean, it's very childlike. He's like, I want a friend forever, one that won't leave me, one that won't betray me. But then you realize he's being literal. He wants to physically make sure that you're never out of sight. What's the only way you can make sure a friend doesn't betray you? If you kill him and stuff him and put him in the corner like a doll. For someone who's afraid of being betrayed, you're kind of betraying your friend, you know, by ending his life. The ultimate betrayal, some might say.
Because you have them always. We could watch them. Unfortunately, to do that, you'd have to end their life. To mitigate this urge, I started to collect random shrunken heads and replica human faces.
That's what he came up with. That's his solution. Well, I don't want to kill anyone, but I've got these urges. eBay to the rescue. I mean, where the fuck do you buy shrunken heads? I don't think every neighborhood has a witch doctor. Because that's who you'd have to go to, right?
Having these heads around gave me a sense of peace. There's a tranquility there that comes with permanent friendships.
So what is being displayed on the screen here, it looks like ripped, like, flesh, right? Like someone just skinned someone's face. So it's got everything. It's got the eyebrows still attached, got the nose, and you know, eyes are closed. But the skin around the face is cut in an oval. Do you think when he's particularly nervous that one of his skinned friends might leave him, he wears the fucking thing? Like, he just puts the flesh right over his face? Also, he's given up, I guess, on human friendship. right now he's just working on building a relationship with shrunken heads and scalped faces. He says it right in the video there. There's a tranquility in permanent friendship. Maybe it's better that his friends are purchased in occult shops. It would be very dangerous to be this dude's object of affection. Well, Dr. Phil sat down with this guy and spoke to him.
Well, many of you might think John is making up his thoughts of torture and killing because...
Why would anyone think that?
...who thinks in such a disturbing and extreme way. Well, John says thankfully for the past 18 years, he's had a team of doctors helping him with his urges.
Yeah, the segment or the episode is titled something like, My Constant Urge to Become a Serial Killer, which I thought was Ted Cruz's autobiography.
He says one of his fantasies almost came true when an unsuspected visitor knocked on his door.
Ooh, a potential permanent friend.
Take a look.
These fantasies of keeping people with me have been around since I was 16 and 17. When we moved into our new house, I actually created a separate compartment to this walk-in closet where I fantasized maybe keeping somebody there. For instance, these Jehovah's Witnesses who would visit. There was this particular female.
I mean, if you're going to kill someone, I could almost condone killing a Jehovah's Witness. No. Guys, please don't kill Jehovah's Witnesses. I always have to sort of like... walk my statements back, because I'm not sure exactly who's listening to the show. There's some very deranged people, and I don't need to be blamed for, religious killings. But goddamn, they are annoying. Jehovah's Witnesses just came to my door earlier this week. It was two black ladies, and they were out of breath because to get to our front door, there's a bunch of steps. That kind of made me laugh. Two big fat Jehovah's Witnesses. Wheezing and gasping for air when I opened the door. They even mentioned it. She was like, wow, you get quite a workout coming in and out of this house every day, huh? And I just stared at her for a few seconds with a straight face. And then I said, Satan gives me all the strength I need. My heart is black, yet my lungs are filled with fire. Onamonishi wa karamavo. And then I started speaking Latin. And then she was like, oh no, Jesus! And then she ran down those stairs. I mean, gravity kind of helped her. No, that is not what... That's what happened in my head, in my little fantasy. But I was just like, ha ha ha! No, I go through the basement. And then she started asking about my wife and children. She actually said, are you a family man? And then I took a sassy stance, and I winked at her, and I said, girl, what? You cray-cray! And then I extended my hand, all limp-wristed. It's a pleasure to meet you, girls. She really did ask me if I was a family man. And I said, no. And she's like, that is so weird. You're the second guy I met today that didn't have a wife. It's not that unusual. I wish I would have had this drunken head story in my back pocket. I'm going to ask these two ladies if they would like to be part of my collection. Oh, I don't have any brown ones. You ladies would be perfect. So Jehovah's Witnesses do this thing. I guess they travel in threes. So two of them came upstairs. To knock on my front door. The third one, though, stayed close to the ground. And I think that's for, like, if something happens, if things start to go wrong, they've got one that can run for help. Anyway, they came to the house midday, and, I was, like, in my underwear, T-shirt and stuff, because I don't start my day till, like, 5 in the afternoon. But I tried to use the excuse of, like, oh, I gotta get to work. I don't have time to talk to you about Jehovah. But I got a great copy of Watchtower. Oh, it's a real page-turner this month. Apparently, God can absolve you of sins or something. Did you know that about him? That was in the News You Can Use column of Watchtower. All right, I don't know what the hell I'm talking about. Let's get back to this guy, Dr. Phil. Creepy man.
For instance, these Jehovah's Witnesses who would visit. There was this particular female that visited several times, and I envisioned keeping her there.
If
I
could. Like, alive or dead? I'm wondering what this closet is used for. Is it a dungeon or a mausoleum? Also, I don't feel like this serial killer, or would-be serial killer, is telling the truth, which is weird because you'd think he's kind of sounding pretty honest here. I mean, who admits to this stuff? But he's all like, I want permanent friends. What's the even creepier term he used? Safe friends. I want safe friends. Ones that won't ever leave me. But, I'm looking at these, flesh globs that, facial things. I don't know what the hell they are. I don't know. I don't think they're from real people. I think it's fake faces. But they're all women, you know? Every single one of them. And this Jehovah's Witness that he wants to murder, whatever. Also a woman. This is obviously like a girlfriend. He's never had a relationship. He's hard up. He's fucking horny is what he is. No girl wants to talk to him. So he wants to, like, keep one in his closet.
Who would visit? There was this particular female that visited several times, and I envisioned keeping her there. If I couldn't keep her, then...
I mean, this is the real mark of a serial killer. Inviting a Jehovah's Witness multiple times to your house. Oh, that was a great talk. Can you come back tomorrow to continue this? That's probably the most disturbing thing he has said yet. See, that was real quick. He was like, ah, this Jehovah's Witness lady came multiple times. It's the first, when you engage with a Jehovah's Witness, there's like a 75% chance you're a serial killer, but you invite her to come back to your house?
This particular female that visited several times, and I...
There's no doubt in my mind, you're nuts.
...envisioned keeping her there. If I couldn't keep her, then at least part of her to remember her by.
Jesus fucking Christ. I'm desperate to know what part in particular he wanted to keep. Her tongue, so she could always speak to me.
If, hypothetically, I were to keep any part of somebody, it would be the head, because the head is the essence of the person. I imagined beheading her with a sword. Bought the sword, and it was a ninja sword, basically.
I don't know, what is a good decapitating sword? I've seen a lot of kung fu movies, you know, where ninja swords are used. Pretty sure Uma Thurman decapitated a few people in Kill Bill. That being said, you know, life isn't a movie. And this guy is not trained in using swords. I just see him hacking away at her. Why won't this sword go through? I think for you, a chainsaw may be a better option. I know it's not as elegant, but it'll get the job done a little better than a ninja sword. For you.
With a sword. Bought the sword, and it was a ninja sword, basically. Razor sharp. At one point, I went to the Jehovah's Witnesses hall there. I tried to get her to come back with me. It just got more frustrating. Eventually, I scared her away, and I never saw her again.
So close. Oh, my God. God was really on her side there.
You think back on that, do you think that but for some things not falling in place, you may have actually... acted on this?
There was a point one night when I did go searching for a woman I had seen, a streetwalker.
Hey, that is an offensive term, sir. It's 2018. We don't call them streetwalkers. Cock whores. No, that's offensive too. They are penis brokers. No? I don't know. What are we supposed to call prostitutes these days? Prostitutes, I guess?
For a woman I had seen, a streetwalker, and I tried to go find her after having a few drinks, and at the time, the motivation was to take at least part of her home, basically the head. But thankfully, I didn't take
that. He loves the head.
Path. I never ran into her.
And knowing that drinking is a real flammable thing for you, why do you continue to drink?
It's a compulsion, for one thing. And another thing, it does help with the anxiety.
Yeah, maybe you should be anxious, though. You're the type of person where it helps to be a little on edge. You know what I mean? You don't want to be too relaxed. That's when, you know, you get ideas, you get confidence.
So you're likely to murder someone if you drink, but at least you would be calm.
Yeah, I try to maintain a minimum amount.
Wow, Dr. Phil is a dick, but good point.
I drink, but, you know, obviously it makes no sense. It's insanity. I recognize it's illogical thinking.
Were you drunk when you held the knife to the girlfriend's throat that ordered the wrong Chinese food?
Yes.
What was that? We missed that story. That must have been in a previous segment. Although, much like understanding how Jehovah's Witnesses are very murderable, there's nothing more frustrating than a wrong food order, right? Especially when you get it home, you're excited to eat a specific thing, and then you look in the bag and you're like, what the fuck is this? It happens all the time to me. I wish I had a shrunken head to comfort me. Usually, you know, of course, the restaurant is to blame for fucking up the order. But in this case, it was his girlfriend and, well, got someone right in front of him to blame for this massive fuck-up. So, yeah, he's going to take a knife to her throat.
Held the knife to the girlfriend's throat.
I don't hold this against him at all.
Ordered the wrong Chinese food?
Yes. Every time I've done something like that, I've been drinking.
Every time.
We actually have a statement. John tried to kill me twice. He was angered by the fact that I ordered the wrong type of Chinese takeout, and I wasn't taking him seriously when he was telling me that government tried to kill him by poisoning him.
Oh, so he's schizophrenic. Okay, well,
he held a knife
that changes everything here.
To my throat and told me he knows how to cut my head off and kill me, but I am not an anonymous person.
It's weird, but I get the feeling like she knew about his impulses beforehand. But he was like, oh, you don't have anything to worry about. I know you. I only want to murder and keep the heads of anonymous strangers. And she was all like, okay, that makes sense. I'll give you a shot. Pick me up at 8. And now all of a sudden she's feeling betrayed. Like, what? You want to kill me? You want to decapitate me? But you know me. I'm not anonymous. And I trusted you. Boy, what a horrible judge of character.
In the same weekend, he put his hands on my neck and told me he knows how to kill me by snapping my neck, but decided against it.
He showed mercy because he loves you. It's kind of romantic if you think about it. The part that Dr. Phil did not read was the last line of this police statement from John's ex. He even corresponded with a serial killer, Arthur Shawcross, who told him he has to kill. I gotta be honest, this guy seems like he's got a lot of restraint, right? He has yet to kill someone, even though he, you know, desperately wants to. There's a burning inside of him. He starts corresponding with a serial killer, an idol of his, if you will. And his idol is like, you need to kill. You should totally kill. It's the only way you're going to improve, right? You've got to hone your craft. It's kind of like when someone who wants to be a writer types a letter to their favorite author and gets something back. Usually the author's advice is, just write every day. That's the most important thing. You'll get better. And, you know, it's the same thing with the serial killer thing. So, yeah, I'm surprised he hasn't yet killed someone. And if I were the authorities, I'd be looking hard, long, and deep into his life and past, because methinks he has killed someone. Real quick, before we get into the news, Metallica posted a video on YouTube, and Jesus Christ, is this rough. You know I love Metallica. Well, I like that one song, The Memory Remains, for the midget that sings at the end. I know she's not a midget. I know it's a woman. I know it's Marianne Faithfull. But in my mind, that person singing at the end is a midget. Anyway, they decided to play a song in tribute of Prince because they were performing in Minneapolis, right? So they're doing a Metallica-like version of When Doves Cry. And by the end of it, you'll be crying too. Ting. Just that little bit that I played. Can you believe that's When Doves Cry?
If you will, the picture. You and I. The sweat of your body covers me. Can you, my darling, can you picture the picture?
Some songs just can't be turned into metal. God, it would suck to live in Minneapolis. To be in a town that is so connected to a musical artist. So now every time someone performs a concert, you know you're going to get fucking Prince tribute songs. Let me just fast forward a bit here. Let's get to the good part, if there is one.
Why don't you scream at each other? Come on! This is what it sounds like!
And the audience goes mild. I mean, you can hear the lack of enthusiasm in their voice.
Is this woman singing?
Okay, you get the idea. God damn it, Metallica. That was a swing and a miss. And with that, Let's get into the crazy bizarre twist of the fucked up news right now. If you are not a member of the Distorted View Sideshow, please consider signing up, supporting this nonsense. This is how I make my living. This is how the show continues. It's very inexpensive. It's only $6.99 a month, even less when you opt for a quarterly, semi-annual, yearly, or lifetime membership. The Sideshow is DV's member site where you get full access to the entire archive of programs. More importantly, every single week we do shows just for paying members. Yesterday we did a Sideshow exclusive program, and tomorrow I've got another one. Great time to sign up. You get a special password-protected RSS feed, which contains all of the exclusive material and all of the free shows. We even do this thing called Yearly Podcast Archives. It's a podcast RSS feed for each year. So you can plug in like the 2016 podcast archive, and you'll have access to all of those shows. If you want to go and listen to the back catalog, check it out. Superfreaksideshow.com. Again, $6.99 a month. There are other membership options which bring that monthly price down. Superfreaksideshow.com. Okay, three very quick stories, then we'll get the hell out of here. First up, let's enter the realm of politics for just a second. There was a House Committee on Energy and Commerce hearing about Twitter's transparency and accountability. The CEO of the company, Jack Dorsey, testified. And I think it wasn't just about Twitter, though. I guess like this part of it was about Twitter, but they wanted the House wanted Facebook to show up and Google. The real story, though, is that Florida Senator Marco Rubio was there, and Alex Jones was also there, just observing, I guess. He's a journalist, after all. Anyway, during a break, Marco Rubio was talking to reporters, and Alex Jones confronted him. Jones interrupted Rubio as he was being interviewed by a bunch of reporters outside the room where the Intelligence Committee was hearing from Dorsey and Facebook Chief Operating Officer Sheryl Sandberg. Jones is alleging, of course, that Democrats are behind this effort to censor him and people like him. Republicans speaking the truth, or, you know, debunked gobbledygook. Whatever you think Alex Jones is spewing, but he's spewing a lot of it. And the Democrats are behind trying to block him from getting the good word out. So I don't know why he got into a fight with Marco Rubio. Rubio's a Republican. He's not the real enemy here, right? I guess, though, you know, Marco Rubio hasn't been that kind. He doesn't have a lot of nice words about Donald Trump. So in Alex's mind, he's part of the problem. Anyway, I have the confrontation here. So here we go. It starts, I think, with
shadow banning people in masks.
Right, well, okay. Alex Jones talking about shadow banning.
My broader concern is that what we are trying to do in terms of preventing foreign interference in our elections, that technology could be used by authoritarian governments to argue we want you to do the same thing against people that are in our country operating. For example, for them, misinformation would be something like the truth. For them, sowing instability would be supporting democracy. And
but the Democrats are doing what you said China does.
That you got from Sheryl Sandberg and Jack Dorsey on that question.
I think Facebook now is, I think it's important for them not.
So the woman talking is a CNBC reporter, and Alex Jones can't help but interject.
To comply with any efforts to sort of go after freedom.
But what about the Democrats purging conservatives?
The
she's not answering. Just the Republicans are acting like it isn't happening. Thank God Trump is.
Well, also, Twitter is not banning Alex Jones. I mean, he did get like a 3-day ban or a 7-day ban or something, but he's still on the service.
Oh, yeah, it's really weird. There's no purge of conservatives. There's no shadow banning of members of Congress.
Bias in social media?
Yeah, who's this guy? We deplatformed
him. Concerned about bias in social media.
Well, so I think the bigger bias is against freedom of expression. Everybody should be.
It's happening here, but you say I don't exist.
Then a heckler
out of look at this guy. He's saying that I don't exist.
You're not familiar with
I just don't know who you are, man.
They,
I don't know
your
website.
Sure. And they demonize me in these very hearings, and then he plays dumb.
Marco Rubio has to know who Alex Jones is, right? He just started trying to insult Alex. Like, who are you again? Where would I know
Poll
you?
PollWars.com, you know what it is.
Does Google, does Facebook,
that's why you didn't get elected. You're snake-like.
So Alex, it's so easy to get under Alex Jones's skin. Just pretend like you don't know who he is, and here he is. He's insulting Marco Rubio now.
Or, you are, man. I don't really read your website.
Sure, and they demonize me in these very hearings, and then he plays dumb.
Here's the question.
InfoWars.com, you know what it is.
World star.
That's why you didn't get elected.
Do they need to be regulated?
Marco Rubio and Snake. Little frat boy here.
This is obviously like Alex Jones' way of like staying relevant, right? I mean, he's being deplatformed. He is. I mean, Facebook doesn't want him. YouTube doesn't want him. So now he's like crashing press conferences and interviews and stuff so he can get out there.
Yeah.
Calling Marco a snake and a frat boy.
Yeah, sure.
I swear to God, I don't know.
You better hope
you're
deplatforming. Tens of millions of views.
InfoWars.
Bigger than Rush Limbaugh. He knows who InfoWars is. Playing this joke over here. That's why the deplatforming didn't work.
But here's the question.
Hey, don't touch me again, man. I'm asking you not to touch me.
Well, sure, I'll just pat you nicely.
I know, but I don't want to be. I don't know.
You want me to get arrested?
I don't know who you are.
It's not just going to take my First Amendment. It's not just enough to take my First Amendment. Oh, he'll beat me up.
Did you?
I didn't say that.
I am, but he's so mad. You're not going to silence me. You're not going to silence America.
You are
literally like a little gangster thug.
There are people.
Wow. So Alex Jones taps Marco Rubio on the shoulder, and I can understand like Marco Rubio not want to be touched, especially with someone who's being confrontational. Like, don't touch me.
Rubio just threatened to physically take care of me.
Yeah, this is where Alex Jones blows this way out of proportion.
There are people who feel that they're being...
Marco Rubio just said he was going to take a shotgun and blow off my face.
The Democrats are raping the Republicans.
Because at some point, someone
the Democrats are raping InfoWars.
What's the difference?
The Democrats sound like a bunch of rapists. They're raping Republicans and a website. Horny little assholes, these Democrats.
Poor Rubio.
I'm sorry,
we
got to go. Yeah, I got to go to the committee. You guys can talk to this clown.
Oh, yeah. Look, it's a little frat boy. So cool. Go back to your bathhouse.
Jesus.
Compromise at the bathhouses. There goes Rubio, a little punk. Anyways.
Alex Jones looks like a fat, bloated Wolverine right now with his facial hair. So you heard Alex Jones mention a couple times the bathhouse, and I don't know if you remember this, but back during the Republican primary, remember when there was like 20 different candidates, and Donald Trump was in the mix, and we all thought it was funny, and we were like, he'll be out in a month. He'll be eliminated. And the rest, as they say, is history. Well, when it got down to like five or six candidates, I think Marco Rubio was in the mix, and that's when these pictures surfaced. I don't think it was a bathhouse. I think it was just a gay nightclub, right? And in the picture, it looked like Marco Rubio was there. A young, I think shirtless Marco Rubio. And it was kind of hard to tell, though, because, it wasn't a close-up shot. People speculated that it was Marco Rubio, but it was never confirmed. But that's enough for Alex Jones to go on. Alex Jones reports that as fact. He's got the papers. And somehow, like, the gay nightclub turned into a bathhouse. You know how Alex Jones is. At one point during the confrontation, I think you heard it in the clip, he said, he'll beat me up. He's so mad. You're not going to silence me. You're not going to silence America. Alex Jones speaks for America. As Rubio left reporters, Jones continued to berate the senator, calling him a little gangster thug and a frat boy. After intense backlash, as I mentioned, Facebook and YouTube suspended and removed Jones' content for violating terms of service. Again, I think Twitter gave him like a short ban, like one of those like week bans or 3-day bans. Jones claims the companies are attempting to censor him. Second story we have for you today. Yesterday on the podcast, we read that story about a dude who got a 2-foot-long dong stuck in his asshole. I thought that was incredible. 23 inches, big, fat, and girthy. Sucked right into his rectum, and they couldn't fish it out. The doctors had to create a new tool to get it out, right? Well, I may have a story that tops that. Top that. Supersonic, idiotic, disconnected, not respected. Who would really ever want to go and top that? Such a waste of pretty face, but hanging in no one's face. I wish that you would take a look and really stop that. Top that. Stop that. I don't really give a about trying to top that. Top that. Stop that. I wish you'd finally take a real look and really stop that.
What's this?
Stop that. Stop that. I don't really give a about trying to top that. big deal. Unreal. I'll make a fool of you. Yeah. The whitest rap in the history of cinema, courtesy of Teen Witch. A man's claim that he was kidnapped and forced at knife point to insert marijuana and knife blades up his rectum and ordered to smuggle the items into the Thurold jail didn't sit too well with a local judge. The story comes from Canada, by the way. Judge Peter Wilkie on Thursday ruled aspects of Kittis DeWitt's story. You guys know what I think of when I hear the name DeWitt, right? My name is Aaron DeWitt. David DeWitt Taylor. He goes by three names now. That used to not be the case, right? It used to be just be David DeWitt. Now it's David DeWitt Taylor. Like Jonathan Taylor Thomas, but with a bigger forehead and much juicier saliva noises.
Gang all. Welcome to Miko. Welcome to Community Call. My name is Dan O'Connor Castle.
And I'm Ryan. Welcome to Community Call. I'm Ryan Nicholas Ray.
I want you to understand something, especially if you're a new listener. I am not making fun of the mentally handicapped here. I am making fun of the funny way they speak. There is a difference. I make fun of anyone who sounds different. I guess that doesn't really make me seem like less of a monster. I think these are good people. I don't care if they are fully brained, if they're mush-minded. Speech impediments are funny because this is an audio program, you see. I rely on sounds. I can't rely on pictures. Maybe I should just move on because I'm not doing myself any favors here. All right. Judge Peter Wilkie on Thursday ruled aspects of Kittis DeWitt's story didn't sound plausible. The judge was like, you shoved multiple razor blades up your asshole and you didn't bleed out. You're alive. You're not a corpse. You know what my defense would be to that? If I was this guy's attorney, I would be like, could we wheel in a monitor here? And I would immediately play One Guy, One Jar. As you can see, this guy is squatting over what appears to be a mason jar, a glass mason jar. It breaks inside of his asshole into a million different shards. Yeah, he's bleeding, but he's alive. He pulled through. Someone had to post this video, right? All right, back to the story. If you've never seen One Guy, One Jar, oh my God. After the show, Google that. I don't even know if it would show up in Google results. Find it somewhere. It's an eye-opening experience, an eye-watering experience. The judge said that the story didn't sound plausible and that his account was deliberately incomplete. Many questions remain unanswered, he added. DeWitt was found guilty in Ontario Court of Justice in St. Catharines in charge of possession of marijuana and carrying a concealed weapon in his butthole. He is scheduled to return to court on September 14th for sentencing. The 28-year-old man testified at a trial that several unknown people confronted him at a residence in Niagara and drove him to Hamilton. So far, so good. He said he was forced at knife point to insert what he was told were packages of tobacco. Which doesn't make any sense, because tobacco is not illegal. You don't need to smuggle tobacco. He said he was instructed to deliver the contraband to unnamed inmates. Oh, okay. At Niagara Detention Center. That's why he put the tobacco in his rectum. If he failed to deliver, he was told he would be assaulted by the intended recipients inside the jail. The judge said DeWitt's testimony did not inspire confidence in his credibility. Court heard DeWitt turn himself in at the courthouse in St. Catharines and then spent the night in a holding cell at the police station. As preparations were being made to transfer him to Niagara Detention Center, he was captured on video excreting the items from his rectum. He had to take a shit real bad! Two packages were seized. One contained a condom filled with marijuana, and the second package. When I hear package, I think of like an Amazon delivery. Big cardboard boxes. The second package had 2 4-inch-long knife blades inside of it. DeWitt testified I'm guessing it was wrapped in something so the blade didn't, pierce him, but still, risky. DeWitt testified he was unable to reach out to authorities for assistance because he was constantly under guard by his captors. The judge noted, however, that the defendant was alone and had the items in his rectum for like 25 hours. Oh, no wonder he had to shit it out before the contraband was discovered. He said the packages must have caused significant discomfort to the defendant. DeWitt said he didn't say anything because he didn't feel police would be able to protect him once he was in custody. He maintained he believed the packages just contained tobacco. The judge ruled that the man must have been acutely aware that one package was larger than the other. Well, that doesn't mean that, you know, it had blades in it. Just because the packages are different sizes, one package may have had more tobacco than the other. One of those packages, though, was very, very sharp. That should have been a red flag. All right, final story we have for you today. The ex-girlfriend of a Falkirk man over there in the UK blamed herself for not being able to get pregnant before discovering her lover had actually been using a fake dick all this time. He was penisless. Carlos De La Cruz, 35, has no penis and hoodwinked two women with the flesh and blood prosthetic. I'm not entirely sure what that means, but it's grossing me out nonetheless. Did he fill a fake penis with blood? Why would you need to do that? Like, to prove to her, like, I want you to take this needle and prick my shaft. See? It bleeds. All right. He duped these women for years. The perv. Like, why are we calling this guy a pervert? You can't understand why he pretended to use a fake penis. It's a little embarrassing going through life without a dick. The perv from Bangkok, not Bangkok, has been jailed for 3 years, placed on the sex offenders register indefinitely. Was he raping these women? Like, what? Placed on the sex offender registry and handed a 5-year non-harassment order against both of his victims after pleading guilty to penetrating both women with an unknown object without their consent. What was he? Wait, this is a girl. I don't understand what's happening here. Sheriff Sterling told Dela Cruz that he had caused physical and psychological harm to both women by repeatedly sexually assaulting them. So I'm guessing, even though it was this guy's girlfriend, the sex wasn't wanted, which doesn't make sense because he doesn't have a dick, so he shouldn't really have these urges. I mean, fucking the girl with a fake penis is not going to do anything for him. So why would you sexually assault her if she doesn't want it? This is a very baffling story. Can someone explain it to me? All right. He repeatedly sexually assaulted them with a flesh and blood penis. That makes it sound like he dug up a corpse and got a real penis as opposed to a dildo. I don't know. Dela Cruz considers the fake to be part of him and refused to allow the women to see him naked and always performed in bed with the lights out. The sheriff said the first victim was made to feel like it was her fault she was not falling pregnant, and that she now suffers flashbacks. But this is her Vietnam and panic attacks due to the incident. The woman now feels dirty and used. Again, how about a little sympathy for the guy who doesn't have a penis? You know, he was just trying to be normal. She was forced to move to get away from him. The second victim was said to have bled for days after having sex with Dela Cruz around 10 times over an 8-month period, and currently suffers from difficulty with sleeping and eating. Like, if he would have never told her, if they would have never found out that the penis was fake, they would have been fine, right? They wouldn't have had this PTSD or PTDD, post-traumatic deep dicking. Fiscal Deputy Kirsten Cockburn, oh my God, this poor guy. The attorney, is that who was like defending or something? Or the process. I don't know how it works in the UK. What a fiscal deputy is. But her last name is Cockburn. Like, everything must remind this guy that he doesn't have a penis. Anyway, she told the court that Dela Cruz had been in a relationship with both women at separate times between May 27, 2013 and May 14th of last year. Ms. Cockburn said the accused was in a relationship with one of the women between May 23rd and January 2016, and they first had sex in May of 2013. She believes she was being penetrated by his penis. The accused does not have a penis. I rest my case. The fiscal added Dela Cruz and the woman would have sex around once a month despite her suffering extreme pain and only being allowed to touch his body over the clothing. She added, during their relationship, the woman continued to believe he had a penis, even though something was up. Like, she had to have known, right? Ms. Cockburn added the woman suffered from thrush. Jesus.
following sex with Dela Cruz. Apparently, he didn't wash the fake penis. The couple split up in January 2016. A year later, she found out that he never had a penis. The second victim also believed Dela Cruz had a penis, and the couple always had the lights off when they had sex. She also suffered extreme pain from penetration during lovemaking, and on the first occasion had to tell Dela Cruz to stop as she was bleeding. Sheriff Allison Sterling placed Dela Cruz on the sex offender registry for an indefinite period. Defending solicitor Cameron Tate said that his client was a Spanish national. Oh, well, that makes it okay. And had been born female. Ooh, okay. Well, I thought this was just like a birth defect thing. This guy was actually just he's a woman. Well, you know, it was a woman and I don't know, going through a transition. Not quite all the way there yet, though. He added Dela Cruz had developed a male appearance when he was age 8 before officially changing his name to Carlos when he turned 16. The court heard Dela Cruz's gender is now officially recognized as male, so he shouldn't have to tell anyone, and his gender is stated as male on his birth certificate. Dela Cruz was working as a restaurant manager before losing his job due to the media attention surrounding the case, but had recently been employed as a delivery driver. The lawyer added Dela Cruz is currently in a long-term relationship with a woman and she's fully aware and consenting to the use of the prosthetic penis he uses during sex. So there you go. Kind of a happy ending. He found love. That might, meanwhile, his last two girlfriends are still having, you know, fake cock-related nightmares and pussy thrush. Not a good scene. There you go. That, my friends, is your distorted news for Wednesday. Let's do a couple voicemails and get the hell out of here. All right, I'd love to hear from you, freaks. 206-666-4463. That's 206-660-GOD. Other ways to contact me, show at distortedview.com. I'm all over social media, at distortedview on Twitter and Instagram, and facebook.com/distortedview.
Hey, this might be a little rough. I broke one arm masturbating. I tried to switch hands and get a stroke. So here's what I can do. See you. There you go. God, did I lose you already?
Kind of.
Oh, shit. I guess that's one less bitch you gotta worry about.
Let's describe this.
You already fucked it up. Let's try it one more time. Ready? Is everyone ready on that end? I need to know you're ready.
I'm ready.
Oh, shit. I guess that's one less bitch you gotta worry about.
Hey, boo. You put your finger in your dick all man?
No, I have never done. You wanted this, freaks. I would have bailed out of that phone call like 10 seconds into it. But no, I got to play the whole thing because you guys love Spiral Hamfucker.
Hey, what's up, Tim? This is Rick in Baltimore. Just wanted to briefly comment on the whole Jack in the Box commercial thing.
Yeah.
It just amazes me how people can have this fucked up double standard. If you turn on the radio and you hear a lot of the rap and stuff. It's very suggestive. Fuck, not even suggestive. You know,
this guy's talking about a Jack in the Box commercial touting their new teriyaki bowls, right? And the mascot of Jack in the Box was holding two of these teriyaki bowls down near crotch level, or they were on a table near crotch level, right? And he was like, check out my bowls. Look at my big bowls. You know, balls. Very funny, right?
Okay, they bleep out the words, and I'm not going to sit there and be a gatekeeper of morality. Whatever. Who cares? I listen to metal. Whatever. But it's popular stuff. People get pissed off at the Jack in the Box.
I know.
Commercials. I'm surprised people aren't pissed off at Jack in the Box. You know, Jack in the Box. So, it's just people love to get outraged.
Yes.
Very annoying. And it gets really old.
Well, you know, I think Twitter is to blame for a lot of this because Twitter is an easy way to vent, right? To complain about things. And people have discovered that it's very effective in getting retweets and likes and people to follow you when you create a big stink about shit.
Hey, boo. Oh, Rick no. From Baltimore is as much as a cornhole as me.
That's weird. Wasn't the last call from Rick from Baltimore?
Hey, boo. Spiral here, fucker. You ever put your finger in your dick hole?
No! I never stick my finger in my dick hole. Why would I do that? Of course not. That's ridiculous. Leave that to the porn stars with HIV to do that.
Tim, to respond to that voicemail about Asperger's chick and about the horse girl, this just brings back so many fucking memories. I know exactly what she's talking about.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Elementary school. There's that group of few girls who are just, like, so fucking into horses and ponies and that type of dumb shit.
Or like little like 6-year-old girls who love horses.
And at recess time, they would get together on the playground and like gallop, like pretend they were horses, and like gallop around
pony
the playground.
Play.
And it was really weird. And like the rest of us would play
I'm a pony.
Football or basketball or whatever, or the jungle gym type shit. And they would just be galloping around us, making little neighing noises like they were horses. And she's totally fucking right. That is early stage.
You know what I did in elementary school recess? I would walk around the blacktop area. And you know how, like, there are a bunch of cracks in the blacktop? And there's that game where you're supposed to avoid cracks? Well, I don't do that. I walk only on the cracks. Is that a game that a lot of kids play? So I would walk on cracks, and then I would, you know, the crack would end, and I'd have to find another crack to jump to.
You should have fucking known.
It's a fun game you could play by yourself when you're a lonely, unliked child.
Fucking got some help. No friends.
Guess I could have played pony with the little girls.
Fuck man.
That would have made me way more popular, right? Bunch of the other boys watching me play pony, frolicking with the other girls. Ooh, what a pretty mane you have! Let me brush it! Ooh! All right, that is all the time we have on this edition of the show. Why don't you guys email me, show@distortedview.com. Distortedview.com is our official website. Voicemail line for you, 206-666-4463. That's 206-666-OH-GOD. Is it OH-GOD?
If, hypothetically, I were to keep any part of somebody, it would be the head, because the head is the essence of the person.
Spread the distortion, STD. Tell all your friends about the podcast. Don't forget to rate us and review us on iTunes. I will see you back tomorrow, if and only if you're Sideshow members. Otherwise, I will see you back on Friday to end the week. Until then, have a great day. Bye, everybody. When I was young, I only wanted to be
you're going to go to prison and a big black man's going to rape you and give you AIDS. You're going to have a big bleeping up your bleeping.